In a previous video, I addressed the papacy in the first and second centuries, and I argued that it doesn't look like you have a single Roman bishop early on. This video, I want to go to the next era of church history, kind of centuries 3 to 7, 3rd to 7th century, that kind of next season in the life of the church, and talk about the evolution and development of the papacy in that time. And I want to make the argument that the vision of Vatican I for papal supremacy, specifically, I will focus less on papal infallibility in this video, is inconsistent with the on-the-ground realities of the early church. And so, for example, Vatican I defines papal supremacy as a full and supreme power of jurisdiction over the whole church. It declares that both clergy and faithful, of whatever right and dignity, both singly and collectively, are bound to submit to this power by the duty of hierarchical subordination and true obedience. And this not only in matters concerning faith and morals, but also in those which regard the discipline and government of the church throughout the world. So recall those words, hierarchical subordination and true obedience, as we work through these examples. Now, let me address a worry right up front so that this won't be plaguing people the whole time, because some people might already be thinking about this. Why can't the papacy develop? Why do you have to have consistency between Vatican I and the actual practices and beliefs and understandings of the early church? And, I mean, lots of doctrines develop, right? Well, I would say two reasons why I don't think that's a possibility for us. One is that the papacy is more than a doctrine, the understanding of which can develop. The papacy is a living office in the church. And while certainly there can be development and changes in some respects, like the details of what it looks like, maybe to some extent how it functions, certainly to some extent how it's received and experienced and understood by others within the church. So you want to leave room for reasonable variation and development, but there are some boundaries to how much it can develop before you start to rub against the plausibility of the thing in question. Because Jesus Christ established this, so we are told, in the first century for a particular purpose. So there are guardrails to how much that can evolve before you start to undercut the plausibility of the idea. But the more basic and second reason would be Vatican I itself, as well as Catholic teaching more generally, affirms that that papal supremacy is consistent with the vision and practice of the early church. So for example, in session 4, 1.4, Vatican I quotes Matthew 16 and John 21 and says, "It has always been understood by the church that Peter alone among the apostles was endowed with a true and proper primacy of jurisdiction." Right after that in 2.2, it says, "It was known in every age that Peter received the keys of the kingdom from our Lord Jesus Christ. Forever he lives and presides and exercises judgment in his successors, the bishops of the Holy Roman See." Elsewhere, when it's talking about papal infallibility, it says that the constant custom of the church demonstrates this. You can also see later popes, like Pius X in his oath against modernism in 1910, it's in the context of a discussion about the church and the papacy. Immediately after that, he says, "The doctrine of faith was handed down to us from the apostles through the Orthodox fathers in exactly the same meaning and always in the same purport." So I'm trying to be reasonable here. I certainly want to acknowledge there's some room for development, but I think there are limits to how much the papacy can evolve or develop before it starts to undercut the plausibility of the thing, just to be consistent with the Catholic Church's own claims. Okay, so here are 5 episodes that I want to work through. Most of these, in fact, I think all of these, except for maybe the last, well, really all 5 actually, in their own way, are an instance of conflict or struggle, because sometimes it's in the midst of conflict where you can see where authority really resides. And each of these I'm picking hoping that they are representative or illustrative of a larger theme or a larger phase in the evolution of the papacy. So these are 5 episodes, but they give us a window. So they'll be in chronological order here. And they give us a window of how the early church is evolving and developing in her understanding of the primacy of the Roman See. And I basically want to say that there certainly was an understanding of Roman primacy from the earliest of times. You know, Rome was considered to be a kind of bastion of orthodoxy. It's where Peter and Paul both died. It's this prominent church, and then it's the capital of the empire. But the early church did not understand Roman primacy in terms of Vatican I. And so each of these will demonstrate that as we walk through them. And I've actually shortened the list here. I had two other episodes to bookend at both ends to make it a longer stretch of time and kind of give it more completeness. So I had Victor being rebuked by Irenaeus and other bishops, according to Eusebius, sharply rebuked during the context of the dispute about the date of Easter, late second century. And then I had Pope Hadrian and his demands for jurisdiction over Sicily and a few other geographical regions being ignored at Nicaea II, Ecumenical Council number 7. But both of, and that kind of gave you a fuller span of time, but I had to admit both of those are a little more ambiguous. I thought it'd be more helpful just to focus on clearer episodes. So I'll just keep it to these five, and I'll go as quickly as I can here because there's a lot to these. Last thing I'll say, for my Catholic viewers, gosh, I know these conversations are tough to listen to an opposing side. All I can do is lay my heart on the table and say I'm sincerely offering this in a spirit of seeking truth. That is what matters to me. I'm not trying, the motivating impulse here is not to attack someone else, but it's out of concern for the truth of this. I'm sincerely convinced the papacy is not true. The vision of Vatican I is not authentic to the first millennium of church history. I'm sincerely convinced of that. I could be wrong. I'm wrong about a lot of things a lot of times. I welcome pushback, good faith pushback. Any hateful things in the comments I delete, but vast majority of comments I never delete. I welcome pushback. Good argumentation and debate is wonderful. But I'm offering this because I'm sincerely concerned about the truth of this matter, and I'm convinced of the things I'm arguing right now. And it really matters that we get this right. So here's the first episode. Cyprian versus Pope Stephen. Of course, when we use the word Pope in this, till you get to the 6th century, it's not used exclusively for the Bishop of Rome, but I'll just do that here for the sake of clarity so that when we refer to people, we know who we're talking about. So Cyprian versus Pope Stephen, this is in the mid-3rd century. This is right after the Decian persecution, where there's this whole controversy about what to do with the lapsi, or the lapsed. Christians, and even clergy, who compromised in some way. They either recanted the faith, or they, you know, gave up Bibles, or something like this during persecution. And there's disagreement about, how do we now regard these people? How strict are we? You know, what does this entail for the validity of baptisms performed by someone who's now in this category? And there's disagreements among the church. Now, Cyprian and Stephen come into conflict about this. Now, what makes this so interesting is that Cyprian has a very high view of the Bishop of Rome and Roman preeminence in general, the whole church. He thinks of the Roman church as having a unique distinction because this is where Peter ministered and died, and he sees it as a source of unity. You can read his book on the unity of the church. He has some very praiseworthy things to say about the Roman church, but he also makes it clear that he doesn't believe that the Roman bishop has authority over other bishops. In the midst of their conflict, Stephen is insisting upon the Roman practice. Cyprian calls a synod, and 87 bishops gather in Carthage, where Cyprian is the bishop, and they solemnly repudiate Stephen's position. Now, I want to read from the synod, and you can listen to the logic by which they make this statement. They say, neither does any one of us set himself up as a bishop of bishops, nor by tyrannical terror does any compel his colleague to the necessity of obedience, since every bishop, according to the allowance of his liberty and power, has his own proper right of judgment and can no more be judged by another than he can himself judge another. In a letter to Stephen, he emphatically denied that the Bishop of Rome has some kind of supremacy or authority beyond that of other bishops. He wrote, Peter did not assert that he had the rights of seniority and that therefore upstarts and latecomers ought to be obedient to him. That word seniority is the Latin word primatus, which can be translated primacy or supremacy. And he makes it very clear, he actually, most people think, made some revisions to his book on the unity of the church because of this episode, where when he's defining the Petrine office, He is explicit in saying that the remaining apostles were necessarily also that which Peter was, endowed with an equal partnership both in honor and of power. And Cyprian insists that the power of the keys given by Jesus Christ to Peter in Matthew chapter 16 is shared among the church, among the apostles. And this is a very common view throughout the patristic era among the fathers, in Augustine and many others, all the way up to Bede and Isidore of Seville and figures like that at the end of the kind of like transfer into the medieval period type figures. The theme or the pattern or the larger kind of phase of the papacy that this episode is kind of a representative of is, I would say, like this, that throughout the 3rd century, throughout certainly the late 2nd century, and into the 4th century, for the most part, throughout the 4th century, this is a kind of general recognition that this is a good, not a misleading exception. Rather, this is a good window or snapshot into the on-the-ground realities in the church, that Rome has a preeminence. Rome is looked to as kind of a guardian of orthodoxy, the Roman Church. But the Roman Church and the Roman bishop in particular is not perceived to have authority over the other bishops. So there's a problem here. There's a discrepancy or an inconsistency between the vision of Vatican I. Remember that language? Hierarchical subordination, obedience, you know, whatever, all the rest of the church, whatever their rank, owes this to the Roman See, and what Cyprian says, which is different from that and inconsistent with it, where he says no one bishop has authority over the other bishops. This is a shared authority among the bishops. Those are two different understandings of the nature of Roman primacy. Okay, here's the second episode. This is the North African bishops against Popes Zosimus and Celestine in the early 4th century. So during the 5th century, you see a dramatic increase of papal authority. At this time, people are making appeals to the Roman bishop. That's not exclusively made to the Roman bishop. You can find similar appeals made to other prominent bishops of prominent metropolitan areas. But the Roman bishop is dramatically expanding in his authority. So you can see in the context of the Pelagian disputes, North African bishops appealing to Pope Innocent I and then utilizing his confirmation of the decisions of their councils to buttress their position over and against the Pelagians. But then when Innocent's successor, Pope Zosimus, vacillates on that and starts courting the Pelagians, tension comes in between the North African bishops and the Roman bishop, and this continues on for several bishoprics. So you've got, it all kind of all comes to a head with the issue of the excommunication of an African priest named Apiarius, who is excommunicated by Urbanus of Sicca. Sicca is a city in North Africa in modern-day Tunisia, and Apiarius appeals to Pope Zosimus. So here's where you get one of these power struggles where you can tell how authority was actually understood throughout the church. Zosimus understands himself to have the right to arbitrate this situation, and he appeals to one of the canons of the Council of Certica, which is a local synod in the 4th century, 343. But he quotes it incorrectly as a canon of Nicaea, so this creates a lot of confusion. And that canon 5 of Certica basically says, when a bishop thinks he has been unjustly deposed, he can appeal to Rome. The North African bishops resist. They take the other view. They say this is a local matter. We have jurisdiction. And they quote the actual Canon 5 of Nicaea, which basically says that locally the bishops should handle such a situation as this. Now, this is a window into a larger question here of at what point does this idea of universal jurisdiction come in? Because I've made the argument in other videos that Canon 6 of Nicaea is contrary to universal jurisdiction, and I think it is, as is Canon 2 of Constantinople. Both these 4th century councils have canons that explicitly delimit the authority of the Roman bishop to a regional authority for questions like the confirmation of the appointment of bishops, adjudicating in a matter of excommunication of a bishop, things like this, and it links Rome with Alexandria and Antioch as having comparable kind of local jurisdictions. Now, that's not necessarily at odds with universal jurisdiction, because you've got these different levels of jurisdiction: a local episcopal level, metropolitan, patriarchal, and then universal. And so Catholics have a way of reconciling that, and they appeal to Sardica as well. But here's how it actually plays out. See, what are the distinctions that are authentic to the fourth century themselves? How would someone in that time have read these canons? Or, as we're looking at now, in the early 5th century. Well, as it turns out, the Roman, the North African bishops continued to resist Zosimus. They continued to resist his successor. Zosimus has a very short bishopric, his successor Boniface, and then Celestine. And they write a letter to Pope Celestine. And basically what they're saying is, you're out of alignment with Nicaea, we're in alignment with Nicaea. But I want to draw attention to the logic by which they make that claim. They say, for they, and that's the bishops authoring Nicaea, have ordained with great wisdom and justice that all matters should be terminated in the places where they arise, and did not think that the grace of the Holy Spirit should be wanting to any province, for the bishops of Christ wisely to discern and firmly to maintain the right, especially since whosoever thinks himself wronged by any judgment may appeal to the council of his province, and even to a general council, unless it be imagined that God can inspire a single individual with justice and refuse it to an innumerable multitude of bishops assembled in council. In his commentary on this episode in the Oxford Studies in Historical Theology series, a fascinating book called The Papacy and the Orthodox, walks through all 2,000 years of church history, looking at trying to give a very fair look at both sides, Catholic and Orthodox views of the papacy. Ed Sachinsky, I believe you pronounce his name, he's a great scholar, I've really enjoyed his book. He notes that, here's his interpretation of this. He's saying the North African bishops recognize the Roman bishop as a resource, as a source of advice, and as a seat of judgment. But they don't think of him as a kind of supreme judge or someone who has authority over them. And he describes it like this. He says that in this letter, which is a strong letter, I mean, you can tell their sarcasm at points and even perhaps their indignation at points in this letter. He says, the African bishops now rebuffed the Pope in the strongest possible terms. They had spoken. The matter was finished. That's not an atypical statement for the scholarship on this episode. It's hard to get all the feel of it. I feel like I just went through a lot of information. The basic idea here, and we don't want to overstate this, you know, Pope Celestine looked to as a authority. But this is not Vatican I. I mean, can you imagine an episode like this playing out today, where the bishops are resisting the Pope like this and then writing a letter like this to him? Remember Vatican I's language about it says it's also in regard to the discipline and government of the church throughout the world. The theme here that we could abstract is that as you get to an expansion of papal authority in the 5th century, here's what happens over and over again. And this episode with Pelagianism and the North African bishops is a great example of it. When the Roman pontiff agrees with the judgment of other bishops, they are happy to appeal to him and utilize his judgment. When he disagrees, when there's conflict, they're also happy to ignore or in some cases resist his judgment. And again, this is inconsistent with the vision of Vatican I. Here's the third episode, Leo the Great on Canon 28 of Chalcedon. So now we're here pushing just a little further into the mid-5th century at this point. And this is a significant episode because Leo is often seen, his pontificate is often seen as kind of the key milestone or one of the key moments in the evolution of the papacy. He's a very authoritative, very compelling pope. And of course, he's the first pope who's called the Patriarch of the West. And he has a very significant role at the proceedings of Chalcedon, where his tome is read and the other bishops say, Peter has spoken through Leo. Some people, just hearing that alone, they think, this is a proof of the papacy. Of course, there's all kinds of questions that need to be worked through. One of them is, what is the role of Cyril, who's also appealed to as an authority? The other, though, is, well, are the bishops saying Peter has spoken through Leo? That was a common thing to be. That in and of itself doesn't tell you very much. Are they saying that because Leo's tome is correct and in their judgment? Or are they saying that because, well, Leo has spoken whatever he would have said, we go with? Do you see the difference? It's actually, you need to do a lot of work to try to understand what did they mean by that? How did they understand that? What was the perception of the Roman bishop by the other bishops throughout the church? And we'll talk more about, in the next episode, about ecumenical councils in general. But here, let's talk about how the bishops, how the aftermath of Chalcedon plays out. Because what happens is, despite accepting his theological verdict in this, and as well as that of Cyril and others, and approving that, they don't accept Leo's kind of ecclesiastical vision. And Canon 28 was very controversial. Initially, Leo did not accept it and wrote in his letters, you can see two concerns that Leo has with this canon, why he's so concerned about it. Okay, so let's just do a quick overview here. Canon 28 of Chalcedon is reaffirming and expanding Canon 3 of Constantinople. Canon 3 of Constantinople had famously said that Constantinople is the new Rome, and then you have all this debate about in what sense is Constantinople second to Rome. Well, Canon 28 of Chalcedon speaks to that, and it's addressing this question of what was the basis for Roman primacy? Was it because it was the capital of the empire? Or was it because it was the See of Peter? Now, you can, of course, find claims to both of those among the fathers, and of course, they're not mutually exclusive. But some people call this the principle of accommodation or the principle of apostolicity. What's the root cause for Roman primacy? Was it Petrine or was it imperial? Okay, and the canon is unmistakably making an appeal on the basis of accommodation. In other words, it's because it's the capital of the empire. That's why Rome has primacy. So listen to the logic of this. The fathers rightly accorded prerogatives to the see of older Rome, since that is an imperial city, and moved by the same purpose, the 150 most devout bishops, this is at Constantinople, apportioned equal prerogatives to the most holy see of new Rome, that's the city of Constantinople. Reasonably judging that the city which is honored by the imperial power and senate and enjoying privileges equaling older imperial Rome should also be elevated to her level in ecclesiastical affairs and take second place after her. Now, as we said, Leo's very upset about this canon, and it leads to some conflict, and he takes a while before he affirms it. There's two reasons you can tell from his letters why Leo is upset. One is, seems to elevate the role of Constantinople too high. Second after Rome, now becomes a little clearer what that means. But the main concern he has, secondly, is the logic of it, because it's clearly appealing to the principle of accommodation, not the principle of apostolicity. Leo wants to say, it's not about being the capital of the empire. It's about being the see of Peter. But the Eastern Orthodox tradition has generally accepted Canon 28 and the logic behind it all throughout her history. In the 19th century, the patriarchs of Constantinople, Alexandria, and Jerusalem wrote a letter of response to Pius IX, and they're basically arguing that Leo's, well, among other things, they're also saying that Leo's tome was accepted there on the basis of a careful examination of it by all the bishops, and they say that this offers, quote, manifest proof that an ecumenical council is not only above the Pope, but above any council of his, end quote. And they further make the case that the reason for Roman primacy and the ancient prerogatives given to Rome was because it was the imperial city. Now, I'm not trying to say that that is correct and Leo is wrong right now. I'm just trying to draw attention to the fact that even here, in the mid-5th century, with this massive expansion, this is typically in the past when I've said, yeah, I think by the mid-5th century you've got some conception of papal supremacy, though it's still resisted and opposed by some. But what you actually see, though, is there's different visions, not only of the extent of papal power, but also of the basis of papal power. And it's just interesting that even into an ecumenical council, you can see the affirmation of this principle of accommodation, that Roman primacy is an imperial honor, not a Petrine authority. Whether that's right, or I think the Orthodox actually have a pretty good case on that, and that's still here in the mid-5th century with one of the most authoritative popes at that time. Okay, episode 4, we're nearing the end here. If you've persevered this far in this video, God bless you. I know this is a lot of details. This is Pope Vigilius versus the 5th Ecumenical Council, that is Constantinople II. This is a fascinating and kind of dark and depressing episode. It's not the church at her finest. It's just so much political intrigue and drama and flip-flopping back and forth, you know, from everybody. It's not a good time. But the larger window or theme here for this episode is, what's the relation of the Roman bishop and the ecumenical councils? You know, Vatican II says that it's the prerogative of the Roman pontiff, it says, to convoke, preside over, and confirm ecumenical councils. I often point this out, and I find it perplexing, and I've not heard a good answer to this. You know, why did 0 out of this first 7 ecumenical councils, and even some of the later general councils, get convoked or presided over by a Roman bishop? Some of them, like Constantinople I, the Roman bishop isn't even invited or aware of it, and he doesn't send any legates. So the Roman bishop is not kind of, you know, leading the charge with these councils. Moreover, on several occasions, it's clear, I think, that the early church perceived the ecumenical councils to function with a definitive authority over the papacy. So if the theme or principle from episode 3 that I just went over was that there were competing visions of the basis of Roman primacy as well as of its extent, the principle or theme here is that conciliar authority was perceived to be greater than papal authority throughout the early church, even into these later ecumenical councils. So Constantinople II is one illustration of this fact, I think. So Pope Vigilius this is kind of into the mid-6th century. Council takes place in 553. This is during the 3 chapters controversy, where basically in the aftermath of Chalcedon, the Byzantine emperor Justinian is trying to bring peace and kind of conciliate some of the Oriental Orthodox. And so he has these 3 older texts that he condemns, and he's trying to get the bishops to agree to their condemnation. Initially, Pope Vigilius agrees with that and condemns the texts, but it leads to this huge backlash in the West, and so he flip-flops and he rejects his condemnation. By the way, I'm not going to bring up Vigilius as an example related to papal infallibility. I think Honorius, who basically was a monothelite, is a better instance of that, just a little later. And Honorius was anathematized at the next ecumenical council, number 6, Constantinople III. I don't bring Vigilius up for that point, but I do think he raises the question of what's an ex cathedra statement and not, because his first decretum that he eventually recants and goes back on was, if you lived at that time, you would have thought this was ex cathedra. He's saying officially, we declare and hereby pronounce and so forth. But let's leave that aside for now and just again back to the ideas of papal supremacy. So Vigilius flip-flops, he goes back, and he's in Constantinople in this context when Justinian convokes Constantinople II, the council. Vigilius declines to attend, and he opposes the decisions of the council. And basically, Justinian reveals in the proceedings his correspondence with Vigilius, exposes how kind of calculating Vigilius has been, kind of humiliates him. And the bishops remove his name from the diptychs, which was an act of excommunication, not of his office, but of his person. And they certainly carry through with their condemnation of the 3 chapters. And he's put in house arrest, and his advisors and the other people who attend to him are taken away. And he's really kind of browbeaten into submission. And about 6 months later, he finally agrees to condemn them. So this wrong, you know, like I, you know, not trying to, I wouldn't want to draw anything from what Vigilius does while he's under duress. Okay, that wouldn't be fair. What is interesting to note, and the purpose for which I highlight this episode is this. What was the understanding of papal authority among the other bishops? This is an ecumenical council. It was confirmed by Pelagius I, the next bishop of Rome. How did the other bishops perceive Vigilius's role? I mean, can you imagine today, after Vatican I, how things would play out differently? You can read through the sentence and the acts of Session 7, I think it is, of Constantinople II, where they reference, the bishops are writing this, they reference the absence of Vigilius, they condemn him for his absence, for not coming. And then they talk about from Acts 15 up through the first four ecumenical councils, and they basically say it's appropriate for us to make judgments about this matter. We have the authority to make this decision. They quote verses like Ecclesiastes 4:9, which says two are better than one, and the verse in Matthew 18, where Jesus says, wherever two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them. They're basically saying through our consensus has authority to make, not only to make a theological pronouncement over and against the Pope, but to actually to bring the Pope into discipline for his view. And this is one of the first seven ecumenical councils. Think how different this is from Vatican I. You know, at Vatican I, one of the cardinals proposed adding that the Pope is assisted by the council of the bishops manifesting the tradition of the churches. And Pius IX famously rejected this by saying, I am the tradition. Think of how different Constantinople II is from Vatican I, and how papal and conciliar authority are counterbalanced against one another. Even many Roman Catholic historians admit that this is an instance of conciliar authority trumping papal authority. Here's how one Roman Catholic historian, Klaus Schatz, puts it in his History of Papal Primacy. Constantinople II not only condemned those three chapters, but even excommunicated the Pope. This was a unique case of an ecumenical council setting itself clearly against the Pope and yet not suffering the fate of Ephesus II. Instead, over time, it was accepted and even recognized as valid by the Pope. The council got around the papal opposition by referring to Matthew 18:20. No individual council could therefore forestall the decision of the universal church. Okay, here's the final episode. This is Maximus the Confessor while he's on trial. So here we are in the 7th century. This is after papal authority has been expanded and developed a little bit further. This is after like Gregory the Great and other popes like that. And yet you still have differences between the East and the West, particularly in how papal authority is understood. And these are kind of simmering under the surface, occasionally flaring up. Then, of course, they lead to schism in the 11th century, among other issues. I think papal authority was one of the issues in the background of the filioque clause. So here's something interesting. And this is probably the least forceful of these 5 points, but it's still interesting and it relates to contemporary discussions I have. Even among theologians who have the strongest affirmation of papal authority, such as Maximus the Confessor, you still find statements that Rome's faithfulness to the gospel is necessary for her authority. So Roman authority is conditional upon her fidelity to pure doctrine. So, for example, when Maximus is put on trial for his opposition to monothelitism, and I was just reading about this, he had his tongue cut out and his right hand cut off, so he couldn't speak or write in favor of his view. Just made me think, wow, most people today don't even care or know anything about monothelitism, and he's getting tortured for his stance on it. It's pretty admirable of him. And eventually the church, of course, you know, vindicated his position. But Maximus is one of the great supporters of papal authority. He's going on many occasions about all the churches look to the Roman church from around the world. And he's got lots of praising statements about Roman authority, Roman primacy. But when he's on trial, the question comes up to him, hey, Maximus, what if the Roman authorities get together with the Byzantines and take their view and go with the monothelites? And Maximus's response is not, that could never happen. His response is basically Galatians 1. This is a famous Protestant proof text. He said, the Holy Spirit through the apostle condemns even angels who innovate in some way contrary to what is preached. This is an episode that's seized upon in a lot of these books, these history books about papal supremacy. I don't want to put a lot of weight on this one episode. I know there's a lot of debate about Maximus's views. I just find it interesting, I think, because I've had so many conversations where I say to my Catholic friends, hey, try to understand my dilemma. You know, what would you do if you thought the papacy kind of went off the rails? Because that's basically what Protestants think. It's like, it's no longer playing home base for Christianity. It's gone and it's deviated. And the response I generally get is, it couldn't, you know, that couldn't happen. And here it's just interesting, and this would be the larger theme of this, that even among the strongest late patristic, really more early medieval proponents of papal supremacy, they don't think like that. They have a category for Roman primacy being conditional upon her fidelity to true doctrine, which is, of course, the rock of the Protestant view. Succession of doctrine trumps all else. If you depart from the doctrine, it doesn't matter what office, what authority you have. Thanks for watching this. If you persevered to this point in the video, I wish I had a prize for you, because this is a lot longer video. But I would say, in conclusion, in light of these five episodes, you can see a development and a trajectory throughout the early church's understanding of the preeminence or authority of the Roman Church, and it takes a long time before you get to something that's consistent with Vatican I. Early on, very clearly, and then still clearly in these various phases, and this has not been exhaustive, of course, but I'm trying to give a couple of flashpoints in the development. Vatican I is inconsistent with these on-the-ground realities of the early church. Let me know what you think in the comments. Again, I welcome good faith dialogue. And thank you, those of you who are supporting and sharing my work. That means a lot. Thank you to my patrons. That means a lot for you to be supporting what I'm doing. I really appreciate it. And God bless you. Thanks for watching this video.